Sorry, do you mind not sitting there? You're blocking the camera.
This one is about the Nobel Peace Prize. So that negation in natural language is understated, but and this is joint work with Anne Prele, sitting over there, who came all the way from Montpellier. There have been similarities between mathematical structures that are used to model logics for linguistics and logics for physics, in particular logics for quantum mechanics. So here's the history of some of these similarities. In the 50s, a young mathematician, Jim Lambeck, was working really on the structure of real numbers, rings and stuff like that, rings, modules and things like that, came across the structure of a residuated lattice monoid, and realized that he can also use it to analyze the syntax of natural languages. So this then gave rise to a big school of in computational linguistics, referred to as type logical or type categorical grammars. Now the same structures, well, complete residuated lattice monoids, were sort of reintroduced by Mulvey in the 80s, and he called them quantiles for quantum locales. So he thought if you want to model the quantum phenomena, you need non-commutativity, and thus you have to work in a non-commutative locale, which he called a quantile. And then in the 90s, these guys have been used to sort of give an operational quantum logic by the Belgians. More than one in this room. And then, okay, so these then were reinvented by Girard in computer science as linear logic. Gieter showed that indeed quantiles provide complete algebraic semantics for linear logic, and linear logic has been, I wanted to say, applied by, but well, has been a fascination for computer scientists since then. So this is the past century. In the present century, one century later, in a surprising turn of events, so Lambeck, who was working with residuated lattice monoids, like the monoidal structure and natural languages, changed to something he called free groups, and started redoing all his theory using free groups, theory of natural languages using free groups. And a bit later, Abramsky-Kuke, they used compact loss categories, so the sort of the shift from quantiles and operational quantum logic to compact loss categories and quantum logic by Abramsky and Kuke. And then observe the similarity that free groups are as non-symmetric compact loss categories. So it's sort of the shift from monoidal structure to compact loss structure over a century. So similarities go beyond syntax. In 2005, Anne Prele showed that indeed you can prove that there is a compact categorical semantics for free groups. In the 90s, there was sort of a revolution in the providing semantics for natural languages via the distributed model of meaning, which use vector spaces to assign meaning to the words. And these are some claims, but we never know what Google does, but these are what some claim behind the success of Google using the vector space models for search. And then, again, similarities of three vector spaces, and people observed Van Rijsselaer, also Dominic Peters, who works for Google, they observed that you can use, because these are vector spaces, the quantum logic and interpret the operators of quantum logic to give meaning to logical operations of language. So semantics go beyond syntax. Okay, now let's think a little bit about meaning, and there have been two major schools to providing meaning for sentences, the logical model of meaning and the distributed model of meaning. They each have their own pros and cons. For example, logical models of meaning are highly compositional. The meaning of a sentence is a function of the meaning of its constituents. However, they say nothing about the meaning of the words. The meaning of the word dog is a set of dogs. The distributed model of meaning, they do very well on the meaning of words, but they're highly non-compositional. Like this area, how to get the meaning of a sentence from the vectors that are meanings of the words of the sentence is really a dark area. Not well studied yet. So here is how the logical meaning of model of meaning works. For example, the meaning of the sentence Google bought Microsoft is a function. That needs a noun phrase, Google, and a verb phrase, which in itself needs a verb and a noun phrase. But it doesn't say anything about these needs, the meaning of Google. If somebody from Mars comes down to Earth, he's going to look at this and learn the structure of the sentence, but we'll never know what is Google. I mean, it doesn't say anything. The single don't set Google. So the distribution of model of meaning, my colleague Stephen Clark says, can be the intuition behind it can be explained by this quote that you shall know a person by his friends. So that the meaning of the words cat and dog are similar because they're both pets. They both run and walk, make noises. They can be big, small, furry. As a result, so these facts are reflected in the text in which these words occur. Cat and dog will be both subject to run, sleep, walk, etc. And then to get the meaning of cat and dog, what we do is that we fix an n-word window and then count how many times cat and dog appear within this n-word close to those other words. So we build our vector space. If you want to take all the words from a dictionary as basis, and then count in your text from, for example, on the web, how close cat and dog are to those bases, and this is the vector of dog if you want, this is the vector of cat because it's more furry and stuff like that. Then you can compare the meaning of cat and dog, and this has worked very well, in automatically deciding about pairs of synonyms. There has been a program written and it has worked very well on the web. Right, okay. So developing a compositional distributed model of meaning has been, if not an open problem, a challenge to the computational linguistic community. In 2006, Stephen Clark and Stephen Pullman, two computational linguists of our lab, they suggested that we need to use the syntactic structure of the sentences, like that trees that I showed you using the logical model of meaning, and use the tensor product of the vectors of the meaning of the leaves to give meaning to the sentence. So this was just a suggestion. It didn't really work because you couldn't, the meaning of the sentence, two different sentences, was not in the same vector space, and thus you could not compare the meaning of two sentences. We could not calculate how close the meaning of two sentences were. And then in 2006, Stephen Clark, Bob Cook and myself, we developed a mathematical structure that used this suggestion as syntactic part. We use pregroups, which are compact close categories, and as the semantic part, we use the finite dimensional vector spaces. We showed how, using this model, we can indeed compare the meaning of sentences. They were both in the same vector space. So this talk contributes to previous work in two ways. Firstly, The mathematical structure there was this product category. We look at the pregroup as one pregroup as a category, compact close category, finite dimensional vector spaces, another compact close category, and you work in this category whose objects are pairs, the type of a word and the vector of its meaning. Then when I gave this talk as the previous conclusion of the talk in a club workshop, Louis Crane was in the audience. He said, "Oh, but all you're doing is quantizing syntax, because instead of like quantization in the sense of attire, instead of working in this product category, you can look at these functors from pre-group to category of finite dimensional vector spaces." And I guess this is what has been referred to in conceptual theory as quantization. So we sort of recast that mathematical structure in a functorial way. Then in previous work, we analyzed the meaning of simple sentences, and we showed how the epsilon maps of a compact close category used as substitution can be used to derive the meaning of positive transitive sentences. In this work, following an idea of Aaron Prelev, we show to provide meaning for more complicated sentences. For example, the negative version of a transitive sentence needs that we bring into picture also the eta maps, spell states of vector spaces. And these eta maps do something really miraculous. They sort of do what they're supposed to do. That's what they're called to teleport, to transfer the meaning of the subject, which is at the beginning of the sentence, to the verb, which is towards the end of the sentence, which has to act on the subject, which as a result of the negation is now far from the verb. Right, okay, so what are epsilon and eta maps? So compact close categories, I guess people by now know. This is a non-symmetric version. So for every object, we have a left adjoint and a right adjoint. So it's not only one adjoint, two adjoints for its object. As a result, we've got two eta maps and two epsilon maps from the unit of the tensor to a tensor, the left adjoint, from the unit to the right adjoint tensor A, and similarly for the epsilon. Thus, as for cups and caps, then we've got two epsilons and two etas, and then the combing or the yanking diagrams also, we've got that many. So if we look in the category of finite dimensional vector spaces, the inner products are substitutions. So if we take a vector in this tensor space, what epsilon does, it sends it to, for example, a real number. Whereas the eta maps, if I give one a real number to it, well, one, it will create for me a Bell state. And now using these things, so these are the epsilon maps, and these are the eta maps, and to analyze the meaning of the sentence John does not like Mary, what I really want to do is to make like act on John and act on Mary so that I'm able to say if John likes Mary first and then negate it because there's a not after it. But the does and the not are like obstacles between John and like. So how can I make like act on John? Well, now the eta maps can help. So I'm going to slide John here and then here, make like act on it. And then I'm going to use another eta map for not to reverse the meaning. And then another eta map for does, which is really doing nothing, the identity. So this is what I'm going to show. How much time do I have more?
You have 15 minutes.
So how do pre-group grammars work? Let sigma be the set of all the words in a natural language, and be a partially ordered set of types, for example, noun phrase, sentence, infinity. And then we build a pre-group dictionary for sigma based on this partially ordered set I mean, let it be a binary relationship which tells you what is the type of every word in the dictionary. But instead of just working with the partial order, we're going to work with a free group generated from that partial order. Because some of the words have compact types that come from the multiplication in the free group. That this free pregroup exists and how does it look like has been done by Amprelli and Lambeck. And then a pregroup grammar based on a dictionary is a pair where you have your dictionary and then you fix some types like S for sentence and you say a string of words W1 to WN of sigma is grammatical if and only if there is a morphism from T1 to TN to this S. And this morphism lives where in this free pregroup. So I have some examples. So a minimal dictionary that generates two sentences, John likes Mary, and John does not like Mary, looks like that. So to John, so these are pairs, entries of the dictionary. To John, I'm going to assign. And to likes, this type, it says, like is really a function. It is looking for an argument of type n to its left and an argument of type n to its right. And if you give those guys to likes in the correct order, it will produce for you something of type x. Mary is n. Now for those, one has to be a bit smarter to come up with a different type. Maybe cannot be read intuitively as easy. Similarly for not and the infinitive version of like. And you will see that these sigmas are exactly the things that are going to enable this transfer of information. So N is noun, S is sentence, J is infinitive of a sentence, and these are some index types or glues if you want. And then one generates the free dictionary based on these given types. And is the sentence John like Mary grammatical? Yes, because I have this morphism, epsilon times ID times epsilon, that sends the tensor product of the types of John likes Mary to S, which was the distinguished element of my pregroup grammar. And here is the diagram for it. So I'm going to cut N and NR, Y and epsilon. And L and N, Y and epsilon, and do nothing in the middle. So is the sentence John does not like Mary grammatical? Now I have to work a bit more. But yes, it is, and here is the morphism. What it does is it cancels N and NR, cancel this sigma with sigma R, and L, N. And then in the next step, JL goes with J, JL goes with J, and I'll get identity. And this is the prescription. Now we want to assign meaning to these entries of the dictionary, the pair of a word and its type, in the category of finite dimensional vectors. So for a pregroup dictionary, we're going to look at monoidal functors, strongly monoidal functors from the free pregroup generated over the dictionary to the category of finite dimensional vector spaces. And then because that guy is not necessarily symmetric, but this is symmetric, we're going to ask the functor to send both the left and the right adjoint to one. So Anne had another construction. I hope this works with play. Okay, so what does this functor assign to the pair John and noun? Well, let's say a vector V to the like V star tensor. W star to marry W. Similarly, we do it for those not unlike. So everything, some abstract vector space. And if you want to be like, okay, so what, how does the meaning of John likes Mary look like? Okay, the meaning math is still this guy, but that time epsilon is on V and the other epsilon is on this W. John is a vector in V and Mary is a vector in W. Like is a vector in this tensor space. And what I want to do is to calculate this Dirac expression, really applying this morphism to the meaning of John, tensor meaning of like, tensor meaning of Mary. And this is going to provide me the meaning of John likes Mary. So this is compositionality, right? You agree? So this is the whole sentence. I break it to the meaning of its parts. But I have to do something else on it to get the meaning. So it's not just looking at, right? So likes is in this tensor space. I'm going to write it like that. And after applying the epsilons, I take the inner product of this John guy and VI, Mary and WJ, and I keep the S untouched, right? Because of those epsilons. So substitute John for the VIs, Mary for the WJs, and do nothing in the middle. More concretely, let's do the simplest possible example. Let V be spanned by the set of all men from 1 to whatever. W spanned by the set of all women, Fj. S spanned by two vectors, so the two-dimensional vector true and false. Now like, I can write down like this, a man, Sij, a woman, where Sij is 1, if the man likes the woman, and zero otherwise. Now, assuming that John is man number 3 and Mary is woman number 4, I'm going to put those in the prescription. So, substitute John for MI in likes, Mary for FJ in likes, and I get S34, and I know that it's 1 if John likes Mary, and it's 0 if John does not like Mary. So it gives us a truth value meaning. How about for the negative sentences? Well, it becomes a bit more complicated. We cannot directly use the syntactic, the map of the syntactic reduction of the sentence, but we have to pre-compose it with something else that's going to create for us enough Bell states to transfer John from the beginning to life towards the end. And so first we create some Bell states, then we apply the syntactic reduction. So, right, that is the, right, okay, so fill the type, this is the prescription. What it does is, okay, so this is my John, does not like Mary. So what I'm going to do is to do nothing on John first, apply an eta to create this pair, this star B. Apply an eta to create another V star B, and then do nothing on this tree. In the next lapse of time, do nothing here, apply an eta to create these two, nothing, apply an eta to create these two, and then nothing anymore. So I have now all these spaces created by these two related things, these two related. And then I'm going to apply the syntactic reduction, which is all those epsilons that I explained before. And the meaning of John does not like Mary is the composition of these two. This is the G, and this is the F. And then you can see that, yeah, okay. This is the John is going to go here, 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 till it gets into the subject place in likes, and then I can apply like, then I'm going to do this setup and this setup for nothing. Concretely, let instead of Sij now I have mu ij because of this j guy. They are really equal. So I define like as before. What is not? So it's this vector living in that tensor space, so these two guys are the same, but in the middle, it's really the matrix that swaps the bases. It's called a NOT gate. And those, so these guys are the same, but in the middle is the identity matrix, the matrix that does not. Now let's abbreviate this to not underbar, not underbar. Thus, and do the calculation. Here it is. And really, so this is my John, man number 3, the vector of does, the vector of not, life, and Mary, female number 4. So I'm going to do an inner product here. So M3, inner product with ML. It becomes this guy, so I'm going to now can replace this L with 3 and get rid of this. So now it's DOS and M3, then I will do the inner product again here between 3 and K and etc. And at the end, what I really have from John does not like Mary is what I really want, that first look if John likes Mary or not, then reverse it and then apply the DOS to it. For example, if John likes Mary is 1, so this is that John really likes Mary, this guy is going to make it 1-0, and this does nothing, and I get the 1-0 here. So if John likes Mary is true, John does not like Mary is false. Okay. If you think that the truth valued model of meaning is too simplistic maybe, we can easily do more. So instead of just having like as an atomic word, we're going to assume that like has degrees of love and hate. Let's say it's 3 for love and 1 for hate. And then love and hate have a Boolean. To love and hate we assign truth valued meaning. Because when we love somebody, we really feel it and there is no question. But liking is a bit more complicated. And then if we run that calculation, the meaning of John, the sentence John likes Mary, exactly mimics this guy. So John likes Mary if he 3/4 loves her and 1/4 hates her. And then we can do the same for the negative case. So John does not like Mary, so you do the calculations with this guy instead of one of those before, and at the end, so he doesn't like Mary if he 1/4 like him and 3/4 hate him. I think this is my last slide. Oh no. Okay. So we've achieved what we claimed. Now similarity, so you can, so one of the big questions was how to compare meaning of sentences. Well, here the meaning of all the sentences, well, these examples that I showed at least, lives in one vector space, that of S. So I've intelligently set the types such that the meanings will all be projected to the vector space S. And now I have the vector of the meaning of sentence alpha, the vector of the meaning of sentence beta. Well, do as usual, take their inner product, and this is the degree of closeness, the meaning of these two sentences. Well, let's test it. Well, okay, John loves Aunt Mary and John hates Aunt Mary, they're not close at all. Yes. So this is for this weighted model, so that like is 1/4 hate and 3/4 love. Love and like are 3/4 close, well, they better be, that's how I define them. Does not like and love 1/4 close. Does not like and hate 3/4 close, well, does not like and like 3 to the 8 close. So Anne, when we saw this, she saw this, she said, oh, that can't be, does not like and like should be 0. But well, this is because we define them, like, we weighted semantics like that, so there is some intersection between the two. Our computational linguist, when we saw that, he said, oh, interesting, I'm going to find some examples on the web that this actually indeed is the case.
Structured sentence. How can I? find the morphisms and make everything match up algorithmically. Is that easy?
Just syntactically.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, so so she has done a lot of work. It's linear time, right?
This kind is linear, yeah. It's linear. You can compute everything in linear time.
So type categorical grammars, the part to parse something, you have to draw a tree. And those are really bad. Those trees are bad. You have to draw a tree. Oh, well, I had a tree. For John does not like Mary, for example. It's a tree like that. And but here it's just something like that. Like linear.
That's interesting. So it's cubic time for general context free grammars.
Yeah, that's a general case. These grammars are simple.
Yeah. I have a question. I don't know if it's going to make sense to you, right? But if I wrote the sentence, "This tree is green," right? You could tell me the meaning of that one, right? And it would have a certain structure, right? But then what if I wrote the sentence, "This sentence is false"? Like, what would that? Would that look different from "This tree is green"? You see what I mean?
But syntactically, it doesn't look different, but semantically, yes. But green, yeah.
Because I can't tell you the meaning of that sentence. This sentence is false. I don't know what that means.
Yeah, it's like the Godel. If it's true, it's false, and if it's false, it's true.
Would you get a loop, maybe?
You make maybe some kind of recursion or something. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe traces.
You have a semantic for that? No. You have to find first a semantic vector for false to represent false.
Ah.
Sentences and false, a new object, you have to add something.
I think you would just scan all the pages of the world and just count how many times it says this sentence is false.
Which will be a lot because of the documents about Godel's work. So, but you don't have to, as you assign 1, 0 to the meaning of false, you can think of degrees, right? So then, like green, I mean, you can define green based on other colors. Like a little bit of, what is it, red, a little bit of brown. Green is green. That's all the stuff. So you can assign degrees of falsity, and then.
It's just a quick question. So you use the bell pair and the teleportation property to do your magical thing. Do you think like some higher order environments do some other magical thing in this
Higher order is more than two.
Yeah. So for example, you know, because there is like funny thing, it's just. One part of it that you have this monogamy of entanglement, like at the same time you cannot be entangled with two different things. So
is there a verb that has more than two arguments?
More than two arguments, sure.
Like John likes Mary in the library.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Let's not go there.
Okay, John does not like Mary.
No, but John likes two persons at the same time, so you want to. I want to look at that.
But if you put and, then and gets on its own broken.
But like is itself already three part item. It is already. It has three.
What is the third part of like?
The sentence. You got a sentence. And
you don't need, yeah.
But it's three part at state. You got three things.
How would it more than two if I don't?
Okay, next question.
I'm just wondering, the fact that you use non-symmetry for neither categories, is that related to English having a very clear notion of order of the sentence?
Well, yeah, all languages.
What if you took Latin? Would you get symmetric for neither categories?
Oh, in Latin you don't need symmetry.
They have so much grammar in the endings, you don't need the dependency structure. English uses the dependency structure, what is the object, subject, by order, plain order.
Because if it was not symmetric, John likes Mary is grammatical, and so would be likes John Mary. It's not grammatical if it was commutative.
That would be all okay in that.
Yeah. I don't know. I did it for Persian, and definitely symmetry. Maybe some weak forms of symmetry you can put in. Some weak forms of symmetry work, but not full symmetry for it.
Was there another question?
You said that, for example, you compared the words likes and loves, and you gave them a certain inner product with each other. Could you do, is the idea that you would do some huge scan of the web or some corpus of text, and then you'd automatically generate these inner products between different words? Okay, so if there's, I don't know, you take some, then you take, so you do this for the web, and you find there's I don't know, 200,000 words or a million words or something. But then if you then quotient that by the fact that some of these are related to each other, what sort of, you'd end up with a much smaller dimensional space, right? That would be the number of dimensions of underlying concepts or something in your language after you take out the fact that you've got lots of redundant words. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so this, I think people already do that. So I'm going to say
it's called information retrieval vector space model.
So two things. First, so what we want to do is to really check these things. So to check if really love and hate are not vector spacely close to each other from the web. So scan a lot of documents and see how far apart. What is this end, the window that you have to fix? What is the end that you have to come up, for example, such that the similarity is zero? Or, so test these things on the web, for example, if you trust the web as what really people mean when they write from it up.
To do this for words is now standard practice, this model.
Yeah, the
problem is to
phrases.
Do it for sentences and phrases. That's what this is about. And that's a completely open problem.
Secondly, so
maybe
if you...
You guys can discuss it separately. I think we have a break now. Maybe we should meet here again at the corner for some reason.